When it comes to baking, two of the most common and important ingredients we'll see are baking soda and baking powder. So many different types of foods rely on these ingredients. But what actually are they? How do they work? And how are they similar and different to each other? In this video, we'll be exploring all of these questions and more. Both baking soda and baking powder have similar functions. They work as leaveners, meaning they help foods rise. They do this by producing gas, which gets trapped in the batter or dough. So we're going to start with baking soda because it's a little bit simpler. The easiest way to investigate how baking soda works is by seeing in what scenarios it produces gas, that key piece to leavening. By combining baking soda with a variety of different liquids like lemon juice, apple juice, milk, vinegar, and water, we can see that baking soda produces gas when combined with acidic liquids. We'll also notice that more bubbles are produced with more acidic liquids that have a lower pH. By using a pH indicator, we can not only measure how acidic an ingredient is, but we can also see that the pH changes when we add baking soda. So let's talk a little bit more about that change in pH. Here we have baking soda and vinegar. Initially, the vinegar is quite acidic, indicated by the pink color of the red cabbage indicator. As we add in the baking soda, we'll notice its color changes to purple, indicating that the pH is now neutral. This is because baking soda is a base, and bases react with acids in a specific type of chemical reaction known as neutralization. So to understand neutralization, we're going to zoom in to the particles that we would see in these substances. If you watched our other video on sourness, you'll know that when talking about acidic things, we have to be talking about hydrogen ions. So if we have some water and then add in a little bit of vinegar, we're adding in hydrogen ions. As we add in more and more vinegar, more and more hydrogen ions are present in the liquid. Another way we can think about this is that the acid is donating hydrogen ions or protons to the solution. This is known as the Bronsted-Lowry definition of acids. When we add in baking soda, on the other hand, it's like these hydrogen ions are being removed from the solution. This is because bases bind to or accept hydrogen ions. Now, we do want to be clear. While the concentration of hydrogen ions in the solution is decreasing, these hydrogen ions aren't just disappearing. That would violate the law of conservation of matter. Instead, these ions are binding with the base itself, and this is essentially, quote, removing them from the solution. Now, what happens when we keep adding in baking soda beyond a pH of 7? Or if we simply add in baking soda to water? Well, the same thing happens. The base accepts hydrogen ions, but where do they come from? Well, the base essentially steals one of those hydrogen atoms from water. Remember, water is made of two hydrogen atoms and one oxygen atom. When this occurs, hydroxide is formed. So when we see a pH above 7, like 8 or 9, that's indicating that there's a higher concentration of hydroxide ions. So far, you might have noticed that within these models, we haven't actually talked about the gas, the carbon dioxide that's being produced. So let's take a step back and go back to the chemical reaction that we were talking about. Here, you can see all of the molecular formulas of these molecules, but we're going to simplify this down a little bit so we can really highlight some key pieces. To do this, we're going to use colored blobs to represent certain parts of the molecules, and in particular, focus on the hydrogen and hydroxide ions, as well as the carbon dioxide. First, we can identify the hydrogen and hydroxide ions on the acid and base and see how these would interact to form water. However, vinegar or acetic acid isn't just made up of pure hydrogen ions. There are other parts to it as well, and same goes for the base, the baking soda. The other parts of these molecules are what is forming the other products that we notice in this reaction, one being the carbon dioxide, as well as a neutral salt, because without that, we'd be violating the law of conservation of matter. So now bringing this back to thinking about how baking soda is added in recipes, we ideally want to add the baking soda and whatever acidic ingredient it's reacting with in the right ratio. Not only will this ensure that we get a neutral product so we don't get any funky or off-putting tastes, but it will also result in the maximum amount of product or carbon dioxide gas being produced. Okay, now that we have a good sense of what's going on with baking soda, let's now focus on baking powder because there are some similarities but also some differences that are a bit puzzling. So when we add baking powder to the same substances, we'll see that it reacts with acidic ingredients, yes, but also neutral ones like water. Additionally, we don't see a change in pH when we add baking powder to water. So the big question here is, why is the baking powder producing bubbles, especially if we're not seeing a change in pH? Now, we've done this exact experiment where we've added baking powder to water and observed it many times. And we actually encourage you to go back and do it again and see if there's anything else that you're noticing. One thing you might notice with a closer look is that there is some sort of whitish powder floating at the top, in addition to the bubbles being produced. And that's something we didn't notice with baking soda. So thinking through that, maybe the idea is that baking powder is not actually a pure substance. It's a mixture made of multiple substances. So to investigate this, what could we do? Can you think of any ways in which you might be able to separate out the substances in a mixture? One way we might be able to separate out the substances in a mixture is through filtering. In filtering, we're separating out what is insoluble or doesn't dissolve in the liquid or water with whatever is soluble and is dissolving in the liquid. So we actually tested this out. We added baking powder to some cold water, stirred it to dissolve as much as possible, and then filtered it through a paper filter. Through this, we noticed two things. The liquid that passed through the filter was much clearer, especially when comparing it to the water and baking powder solution, and we were able to collect some sort of whitish powder in the filter. Now, there is a chance that this powder is just the baking powder. There's nothing to really imply that it's been separated out. So what we did is we took this filtered powder, added it again to warm water, assuming that if it actually was still baking powder, we would see the same reaction. We'd see those bubbles, right? The same exact thing. And we were able to see that there are no bubbles produced, which is evidence to suggest that it is different. It's not baking powder, it's a substance that's in baking powder. And that's actually the case. It's cornstarch, which does not dissolve in water. Now, that doesn't fully answer all of our questions, but it is hinting at a key piece here, which is that baking powder is a mixture. It's made of multiple substances. And in fact, baking soda is another substance directly in the mixture of baking powder. Now, in addition to the baking soda and the cornstarch, there's actually another ingredient in there. Knowing everything you know about baking soda, acids, bases, neutralization, and pH, can you think about what else might be in this mixture of baking powder? So, in addition to baking soda and the cornstarch, we have an acidic powder, and sometimes two acidic powders, depending on the exact type of baking powder. Now that might be confusing because so far all of the acids we have looked at have been liquids, but acids can be solids or powders as well. Two common ones you might see in a kitchen are citric acid and cream of tartar. So why don't we see a reaction happening within the container of the baking powder if it contains both an acid and a base? That's because they are in a solid form and are essentially stuck. They need a liquid to help them move more freely and to facilitate that chemical reaction to occur. So if we flip this for a second and instead think about the idea of adding water or any liquid to baking powder rather than baking powder to a liquid, we can understand the importance of a liquid and the role it's playing. It's facilitating those particles to move more freely and to collide with one another. And that's why we need a liquid for baking powder to work. Now, one more thing. Heat also plays a big role when it comes to baking powder. But don't worry, we'll be doing another video all about heat, what double acting baking powder means, and comparing different types of baking powder. So stay tuned for another video and be sure to like and subscribe for more videos.